Hello friends, welcome once again to the NIOS studio. Myself, Dr. Yukti Sharma from Department of Education, University of Delhi. Today I am going to discuss with you development of attitude in children. Now let's begin by understanding what is attitude. An attitude is a dispositional readiness to respond to certain institutions, persons or objects in a consistent manner. So it's dispositional means it's already there in us. And it's a kind of a readiness that helps us to or influences us to respond to certain group of people or institutions or objects or an event also, and in a consistent manner. The phrase consistent manner means that again and again we are responding in the same way. Attitude influences one's typical mode of response, which we just discussed. So its role is basically, and it is visible also, because it influences the response which is visible in the behavior. It results in a state of preparedness or a state of readiness to respond in a particular manner. Now, this state of preparedness or the state of readiness is very important, you know, because state of preparedness could come from a previous experiences also. Like, I had an experience with a particular disease where one of my family members had got affected. And my feelings got associated with it, my emotions got associated with it. So those feelings and emotions give me a memory about that particular disease. And whenever I'll hear about that disease, those feelings and emotions are actually preparing me to respond to it. So my response, or my what we call it as attitude, would be influenced by those prior feelings or emotions that I have with the disease. Or this preparedness or readiness could be related to my cognitive aspect, where I would have read about this disease somewhere. So I know what this disease is, what are its causes, effects, and I know what the preventive measures are, you know. So my response could be that, oh, I know about the disease and these are the ways I can prevent it. So it could be a very positive attitude, where I am confident that this disease could be prevented. So that's how my attitude keeps varying, because my state of preparedness is different. It is being influenced by different kinds of factors. One are my prior experiences, which are relating to my feelings and emotions. And on the other side, they are related to my knowledge, my concepts, my conception of that particular disease. The next point is that we know that attitudes are not observable, but the way we respond to a particular event or object or institution, that comes in our overt behavior, which is the visible form. And therefore, through our overt behavior, we can know that, oh, this person has a very negative attitude, or this person is very optimistic, has a very positive attitude, right? So from the behavior, we are able to know the attitude of the person. The next point which we are going to discuss in this session about the attitude is, which is very important, is that they can be learned or developed. So it's not that we are born with an attitude. We may be having an attitude. I mean, on a lighter note, babies have their own attitudes. But these attitudes are also learned and developed through the experiences that we are going through in our life. Now, so we have to look at what experiences are these. So in the later part of the session, we are going to discuss what are these experiences and factors that make us learn or develop a particular attitude in us. Therefore, we can, when we were talking about how the attitude gets reflected in behavior, when we took the example of that disease, we talked about feelings and emotion on one side, which is influencing the attitude. So that becomes that affective component that you can see in the diagram. On the other hand, when I had the conception about the disease, that is what is called the cognitive component. So attitude basically is influenced by both the components, cognitive and affective. But both can have positive and negative effects also, and both can be rational or irrational. Now, in case of cognitive component, again, if we take the example of disease, if I had just told my students about the disease and they understand that, oh, this disease is that severe, all this happens, I've told them about the causes of the disease, its severity. Now, that can develop a negative attitude in the children. Oh my God, this disease shouldn't happen to me. it's going to be very, very difficult for me. How will I deal with it? It's all negative attitude, right? But if I am going into the details, if I am making them conceptualize, giving them some cases where different people have responded to the same disease in different ways, so I am engaging them with the concept of that particular disease at a much deeper level, then their understanding broadens. They can understand that we can respond to a particular disease in multiple ways. It's not necessary that what is written will happen to me only. It can vary also. There are variations also. And therefore, the person can develop a positive attitude also. So, in case of cognitive component, our engagement and how deeper we go with the concept helps us to develop more positive attitude. And similarly, a rational attitude also. When we go deeper into the concept, we enable children to question that why is it happening? Why this particular cause is associated with this disease? What is happening inside the body that it leads to this particular symptom? So, when they go into the details, they start questioning, and so they don't accept anything as it is. And that is what is called rational attitude. When we are questioning what is happening. And therefore, again, the cognitive component helps in developing a rational attitude where we are engaging our students in deeper ways. We are engaging them with many kinds of examples, with a variety of experiences, and not just by telling them, not just by giving a piece of information to them. Now, coming on to affective component, similar thing happens there also. If I have a experience which is not very good, which was very unpleasant with a particular disease, I have my feelings and emotions. Now, that should be addressed in the classroom. When I am talking about a disease, I should tell my students to share their experiences. If somebody in their family had or in their community, now when they come out with this, they are in the process of dealing with it also. They hear others' experiences also. And their others' experiences could be positive. They could have some positive feelings and emotions related to the same disease where the person might have recovered from it. So, when you hear others' experiences, again your affective component also broadens. You don't cling to your own feelings and emotions. You get to hear others' feelings, emotions also, and your attitude may develop towards a positive side. Similarly, deeper engagement leads to rational and irrational also, where I am not listening to others and I am just saying, nahi, mujhe nahi pata, I don't know, but I have a very bad feeling about it. There, I am totally being irrational. I am not trying to understand why it happened, how it happened, how I can come out of it. I am being rational when I try to hear others' experiences also. And then using my experiences and others' experiences, I am generalizing that what could be the causes and how it can be prevented. So, both the cognitive and affective component interact with each other. And that's how the attitude develops and shows in terms of behavior. So, behavior therefore is actually what is representing our attitude in terms of the individual actions that we take, and it therefore represents the ideas and feelings that we have about the object or a person. Now, this interaction between cognitive and affective component can also be taken up using a topic from science classroom. Now, suppose in the science classroom, the teacher is discussing the issue of global warming. We do have in our objectives of teaching, you all are teachers and you know you write objectives like to develop a positive attitude towards a particular concept. So, although it's a long-term objective that we envision that should happen in many classes, but some small steps could be taken in few classes. Now, in a science classroom, if the issue of global warming is discussed, and we are merely sharing about the issue. See, this is how it happens and how and which countries have got affected and how they have got affected. So, we are merely creating an awareness about the issue because we are only sharing the information with the students. We are not trying to engage them with the concept per se. It's only a body of information which we are giving to them. Now, this may definitely lead to their participation. they may stand up and say that, ma'am, I want to participate in a project which is on global warming, or I may, you know, want to make a PowerPoint presentation on it. So they may start participating in the activity, but doesn't mean that their attitude has changed towards it. So attitudinal change requires something more. Now what's it? Let's see. Now if the learner, if a kind of a discussion is happening in your class where the learner is able to see his or her role in addressing the issue, means where the global warming issue is not seen as something which is global, is also seen something which is local. It's also starting from my community. I am also doing certain things which is leading to global warming. So when the learner is able to see his or her role in addressing that issue, definitely the learner has started thinking from his or her own perspective. So the thinking has started. As soon as the thinking starts, the cognitive component is going to now engage deeply about the particular concept. In that case, the learner may come out with their own ideas. Ma'am, I have an idea, you know. If we stop these practices, greenhouse gases will reduce, and that will definitely reduce global warming. So the child has not only understood the causes of global warming, but is also trying to apply it in his or her condition, circumstance, and in his or her community, and is trying to analyze the situation also. So therefore, a deeper level of thinking, a higher order thinking is taking place in the child. So somehow, some attitudinal change is taking place because the child is responding in a different way to the same issue. Next step could be where the child shows commitment to the cause, which is not because of compliance to any norm or rule. Not because you as a teacher has told, see that you don't have to do certain practices if you really want to work for this cause. But the child is taking some steps in the school on his or her own because the child now feels for the cause. This is how my planet is getting affected. What can I do as a person who is living in the same planet? So when the child actually feels, so that means the cognitive component somehow has also influenced the affective, the feelings of the child. And that is where the attitudinal change may take place. And it is where the child can stand up in the class and take their own standpoints also, that I am going to do these certain things which will reduce the use of CFCs and therefore will also reduce global warming. So therefore, what I am trying to say here is that attitude development or learning cannot happen in isolation, where we are assigning one class for it, where a counselor is there who is going to develop the attitude. Attitude development has to be developed in every class. Every class, every subject, every teacher has to contribute towards the development of attitude in children. And these are going to be small steps in developing or bringing a big change in our learners. Now, otherwise, as we have discussed by taking some examples, takes place in two ways. One is the primary socialization. Primary socialization are where the child is interacting with the primary groups, the first groups in the child's life, the family, the peer group, the community, neighborhood, religious, ethnic groups. So these first interactions in the community, in the neighborhood, in the family, that interaction brings some personal experiences to the child, which are there in the child's memories, and that influences the attitude. And the second is the secondary socialization. When the school starts and the child enters the school, moves from the family, neighborhood, community to the school, the teachers, the peer group, and various educational experiences also influence the attitude of the child. Now, let's look at the primary socialization. Primary groups are like family, friends, community, ethnic group, a caste group. It could be any kind of group to which a child belongs, which gives an identity to the child, a social identity. Now, when the child is in this group, it exposes the members to some source of information through personal and social interaction. So the child learns from these groups. And these groups have their own unique understanding about things. So those understandings are communicated to the children. And it's their first learning kind of. sometimes these groups also exert pressure on their members to conform to the group norms. So if they believe in a particular way, they expect that their members should also think in the same way. So that also influences the attitude of the child. Develop some common attitudes about things and people. So that's how they develop some common attitudes. And these attitudes which are formed or developed, they are very stable sometimes and they are very resistant to any kind of change. Now coming on to secondary socialization. Secondary socialization is where the education and the school comes in, you know. And the objectives of education is the development of certain desirable attitudes. With the assumption that we know that students come from diverse backgrounds, they belong to different groups, and therefore they would be having different attitudes about the same thing. So that diversity is there in the class, diversity amongst the attitudes, amongst their responses. And education precisely attempts to bring a change in what it considers as an undesirable attitude. Or in other words, we can say it develops certain desirable attitudes which are there in its objectives. Now, some of the desirable attitudes are positive attitude, sensitivity towards others and their unique context. Now, sensitivity here simply doesn't mean sympathizing, but it means that you are aware and you understand the other person's context and the other person's needs. Similarly, sensitivity and appreciation from one's environment, where you are. How much are you aware of your environment? How much do you understand it? How much can you see the changes, micro as well as macro level changes which are taking place in your environment? How are you appreciating your environment in which you are in? You know, so what are you doing for your environment? All that comes in this. Rational attitude is where, as we have already discussed to some extent, where you are looking for reasons, where a child doesn't believe at the hearsay or doesn't believe by what the adults have told to them. Just being something has been told by an adult would be correct. The child doesn't agree to it. The child wants a reason to consider something as valid. So where the child is looking for a reason, that means the child has a rational attitude. Socially bold. Boldness is where the child is able to question. So suppose the child belongs to a particular ethnic group or belongs to any social group, the child is able to question the members of that group for the views and ideas that they have. And proactive attitude is where the person is ready to take any initiative. So this list is not a comprehensive list. I mean, you as teachers may be knowing much more than this and may add to this list, but these are some exemplars of attitudes, desirable attitudes that we look for in our children, that we look towards developing in children. Now, how can school education develop these desirable attitudes? Again, as I said, it cannot be told that develop this attitude. It cannot be preached also. It has to be internalized, you know, through the various components of the school. Not a particular class, not a class of psychology or a class with a counselor, but every class has to contribute. So we will just, because we have paucity of time, we'll look at some of the components in the school and how can they contribute. Like for example, assembly. Instead of making assembly a ritualistic practice, if we can bring something new in the assembly, why not a storytelling session, you know? Stories have always been a very important part of children's lives. Kind of curiosity that it builds up in children because they want to know what next happens in the story, that keeps them engaged with the story. So, similar way, if we can pick up the story of life of Mother Teresa, for example, and take some anecdotes from her lives which depict her boldness, her empathy, her integrity, sensitivity, vision, optimism, perseverance, and we share these with children in the assembly time where, you know, children from different classes are sitting, and then the students can be asked certain questions focusing on her personality and how she was different from other people. So that would help them to engage with what kind of a personality she was and how she was different, how she could take up the task that she has done. And then this session could be concluded by sharing responses of the students. They can also share what they think and what experiences they have regarding the same. Similarly, an inter-class activity where two classes are involved, For example, they can organize a street play on the life of Mahatma Gandhi and share with other children. So they are conceiving the play also themselves, and they are sharing with other classes also. I'm saying it as an inter-class activity because assembly was having a bigger group. Inter-class activity reduces the group now. And further, at the next level, we can have a still smaller group which can be done as an intra-class activity. Suppose in a particular class, in a particular section, I mean, some topic on environment is going on. So why not have a live interaction with social leaders? Like, for example, with my when I was doing my doctoral research with some school students, I made them interact with the Chipko Andolan activists. By chance, they were in Delhi for some meeting and I could know about them. I called them to interact with my children. And similarly, I was teaching the D.El.Ed course, so my student teachers also interacted with them. And believe me, both interactions were very different. Children have their own curiosity to understand others' context, listen to their original experiences. And original experiences, listening to them, definitely affects the mind of children. And therefore, their attitude towards looking at things. So, in live interaction with some of the social leaders will definitely bring a major attitudinal change in the children. Role play. Now, this again can be done at the level of the class, where you are engaging with a particular class. You give them a task where they could just, manage their day-long activities with a bucket of water and what they experience throughout the day. So, actually, my children of class 8, with whom I was doing that research work, they actually did it. And the next day, they shared experiences. Now, believe me, in a class of 40, some children will say that I didn't do. What is all that? I don't like, ma'am. I don't like this activity. They didn't do. It's okay. It's okay. Let them listen to others' experiences. Some children did, and by half day, they left it. Oh, I couldn't carry out this activity. No more. That's it. Some children actually finish the activity and they manage. Now, the ones who finish the activity, they had a feeling of achievement because they could discover some of the alternatives which they could do in order to manage with one bucket of water, right? And when they shared it with the other children, definitely that attitude which that child had developed transfused in other children also. They also started thinking, oh, we could have also tried. So, doesn't matter, you have another day, you can try it another day. So, there should be flexibility where they are ready to change themselves also, ready to give it a try also. This is a small model that I had made about various components of school, starting from the interactive session at the top, which is happening at the assembly level, going to the inter-class, intra-class levels. And in the end, some endeavor should be given individually to the children also. So, look at those children who really have developed that attitude in them, which is positive, proactive. Give them some social endeavors to do that they can bring and share with their peer group. Believe me, if a peer does something, it has much larger effect as compared to a teacher doing anything or a parent doing anything. So, one out of their peer group, if he or she does something and brings to the class, it will definitely bring a attitudinal change in the other children also. Teachers' attitude is another very important component. Teachers themselves are role models, and therefore they should also display these attitudes like being caring, kind, sharing their responsibility in the class. They give some responsibility to the children also. They are sensitive towards accepting the diversity which is there in their class, fostering individualized instruction, understanding and acknowledging their individual needs, and last but not the least, encouraging their creativity. Not looking for conventional answers, but looking for that creative answer, looking for that answer which is different. So, if teacher displays these attitudes in his or her day-to-day practices, it will definitely affect the child also. So, we conclude in these two points that one, development of attitude in children requires that teachers, parents and their community all should contribute towards it. No single teacher, no single class can make a difference. Second, it cannot be taught, but has to be internalized through a variety of experiences, whether in school, home or community. Variety as well as multiple. We just can't think that the few activities that I have shared will bring a change. There has to be multiple such activities which have to be done on a continuous basis in the school and totally ingrained within the curricular experiences, then only we can see a change in the attitude of the children towards what we are expecting them to be. So, hope this session is helpful for you in understanding what is attitude and how can we develop in children. See you in some other section. These are a few readings that I have brought for you, which you can refer to. Also, some part of it I have used in this presentation. So, thank you and see you some other time.